Austen's heroines, we meet them when they're, usually when they're very young, at this very important stage in their life, which determines what the rest of their life is going to be. They tend to be eager, they tend to be intelligent and articulate.
Oh, Lizzie, could you believe things would end in this happy way? I could and I do.
Jane Austen's male characters are splendidly manly. They're reserved, they're strong, they tend not to talk very much, but when they do talk, it's decisive.
I shall conquer this. I shall.
Goodbye.
Jane Austen made a rule for herself that she wouldn't follow the men when the women weren't there. But I think that robs us of seeing the male characters as a whole. So the scenes that I add are generally scenes for the men doing manly things, going hunting, going shooting, going swimming. In Sense and Sensibility, I wrote for Edward a log-splitting scene, like a scene out of a western, something like that, with a great big axe, and to relieve his feelings, you see, because he can never say what he feels about, because he's trapped in this engagement. With Colonel Brandon, I wrote a falconry scene. So that shows power and gentleness at the same time. Just as Marianne is coming across the field to see him, and we're supposed to imagine, yes, he will stroke her feathers tenderly like that as well. So I hope these I hope these things work. And anyway, they're things to look out for, you know, when the...
Jane Austen was modest about her achievements. She said that her books were only about three or four families in a village. But in those three or four families, she found a universal truth.
Even though it was so long ago, the reason it endures is that it has truth at its heart. Truth about human character and truth about female character.
The author, who was so astute, who knew so much about love and marriage, never married.
You still cannot imagine how she made up this amazing series of families and romantic entanglements that is so real and so emotionally, imaginatively true.
Still, an image of Jane Austen as a lonely spinster is misleading. Admittedly, we know little about her life. But what we do know comes from her letters, and they reveal someone who went to parties, loved shopping, and shared gossip.
I danced twice with Warren last night, and to my inexpressible astonishment, I entirely escaped John Lipton.
You say nothing of the silk stockings I purchased, as I cannot very well afford to pay for them. All my money is spent in buying white gloves and pink...
Miss Macklin's are both pretty-ish, with large eyes and a good deal of nose.
Jane Austen was born in 1775, the seventh of eight children in an intellectual family. Encouraged by her parents, she began writing when she was only 11. Even then, she was funny, writing silly stories and little playlets. At 21, she sat down and began her first novel, which she called First Impressions. Her father sent it to a publisher who returned it unread.
We now know, of course, this is the biggest mistake anyone's ever made in publishing, because some 15 years later, after it is revised and retitled, it becomes, of course, the novel we now know as Pride and Prejudice.
After the book's rejection, she went through a difficult time. The family moved from her beloved home in Hampshire, and 5 years later, her father died. Legend has it that there was another blow. Some believe she lost a love, a young man she met on vacation but never saw again. She had at least one other suitor. Harris Bigwither was a man of wealth, a match that would have secured her and her family's future. When he proposed, Jane said yes, but then had a change of heart.
She has a sleepless night, we're told, and the following morning she had decided otherwise and turned him down. Did Jane perhaps decide overnight otherwise, that if she were married, and had a family obligation, she wouldn't have time to write, I wonder.
Her life revolved around her family, her friends, her reading, and most of all, her writing. Sense and Sensibility was published in 1811. That same year, she began revising Pride and Prejudice, which was published in 1813. It was quite a hit. The first edition sold out, and it hasn't been out of print since.
Almost a century ago, here at the Curie Institute in Paris, the notebooks of that remarkable inventor, Marie Curie, are still aglow with radiation. They're a testament to the unknown and dangerous path Marie Curie traveled on the way to a startling scientific breakthrough in 1898. In that year, Marie and her husband Pierre discovered the rare and then unknown metal, radium. It was a find that was to usher in the atomic age. Immediately, it had massive implications for the development of nuclear medicine and the use of radioactive beams to kill cancer cells.
Radiation therapy was actually in use within a year of the discovery of radiation. Since then, it had become a highly sophisticated treatment of cancer. Of all cancers, radiation is the second most used after surgery.
Researching in this humble shed that housed her laboratory, Marie Curie came upon radium by realizing the ore, pitch blende, emitted much more radioactivity than other metals. By a process of elimination, the Curies isolated radium as the mystery new metal that contained higher radioactivity than even uranium.
Their work was extremely important. The discovery of radium opened up a whole new era. It's been described as the nuclear age. Pierre and Marie were the start of modern physics.
Marie and Pierre's work astounded the scientific world. Marie herself had a highly personalized affection for this new metal, radium, a metal which was curiously luminous and glowed in the dark with a bluish sheen. Selling their recipe for discovering radium could have made the Curies extremely wealthy, but they refused to patent it.
They felt no need to patent their findings or seek a financial reward. That meant that every time they were asked how to make radium, they would supply the information. They did not believe in secrecy. With their high moral principles, this would have been out of keeping with their way of thinking.
Born in Warsaw, Poland in 1867, Marie Curie spent most of her life in France, where she discovered radium and put the word radioactivity into common usage. The winner of two Nobel Prizes, Curie helped create a new branch of physics and trained X-ray technicians to serve on the front lines of World War I. Through her research with radium, Curie opened new avenues of medical technology and brought hope to victims of cancer and other related diseases. She went on to win the Nobel Prize again in 1911, this time for chemistry. This was the scientist who researched tirelessly, who challenged once incurable illnesses and opened the secrets of radioactivity to scientific study. This was Marie Curie.